So having said that, I would like to take time to introduce the kind of meditation we are going to prescribe for this retreat as well as generally for this, from the Nisarnavanaya. As mentioned in this rules, the very first thing, we are doing with the Theravada tradition, and therefore whole retreat we can recognize as retreat of Satipatthana or establishment of mindfulness. So my duty is to just introduce mindfulness and to come out with suggestions, to how to incorporate, how to be mindful in our retreat times. So as far as the mindfulness is concerned, it needs so much of introduction as well as the definition, because often we are unmindful. Therefore, whenever the mindfulness is introduced, it appearing something abnormal. It is not in our day-to-day jargon, in our day-to-day activity. So therefore, mindfulness all the time needs kind of a definition. So to make it simple, whenever someone is be here and now, that is, we can, in pragmatic terms, we can say mindful. So throughout the time, we try to individually to be here and now. To achieve this, we come out with three methods. In the meditation jargon, it is called sitting meditation, walking meditation, and to be mindful in day-to-day activities. Whenever we take these three methods in order to incorporate mindfulness into our life, the easiest way to start with is how to develop mindfulness in sitting meditation. So the Buddha, whenever he used to explain mindfulness, he used to give internal and external atmosphere or surrounding before getting into the subject matter. So therefore, wherever he mentioned about the mindfulness, the microclimate and the macroclimate is been defined. So in Pali, if I am to quote, aranyagatova, rukhamulagatova, sunyagaragatova, that is to explain the macroclimate. It is just like an operation theater to have the facilities to have for a successful operation, surgical operation. Likewise, the Buddha says, for this mindfulness, for this meditation, the best place is to entering into a forest. The second thing is, the best vibration you get under a tree. The third one is a solitude place. So whenever you all traveling from all the corners of the world, you all prefer to have this forest. So that is because it is, we have the sense, we can feel it, that the forest is the best, and that is been prescribed by the Buddha also. In absence of the thick forest, we can go under a tree or a place like this. This is called a solitude because this is free from the beings, those who are in the sensuous pleasure. So we each other must make it sure we did not come here to indulge other sensuous pleasures. Therefore, to make the atmosphere, to make the vibration better, we each and every must refrain from this sensuous gratification and the indulgence. So therefore, we must maintain this atmosphere. And once you define and go there, I mean that entering into the forest or under a tree or coming to a place like this, as far as the microclimate is concerned, there are four postures. Individually, we have four cardinal postures: sitting posture, standing posture, the walking posture, and the lying down incline. So out of these four, specifically for the beginners, the Buddha has mentioned sitting is the best. So whenever we get a place like this and a group also interested into the same object. We assume the sitting posture, so I have to take little time to define the best posture. I am fortunate because we have the statue of the Buddha that is to depict how he sits whenever he wish to develop mindfulness and meditation. So if you look at it, you can see once you assume the posture, it is like a shape of a pyramid in Cairo. One complete triangle is touching on the ground. And once you keep the hands in such a way, it is every side it is triangular in shape. So this is the most established architectural structure. You can maintain easier and very little imbalance. Otherwise, in Sri Lankan examples, we can see Dagaba or the Chaitya. It's also a bell-shaped one. It's also well-established. Or the other simple thing is an ant hill, also the same shape. It is well-established on the ground and go up like a conical shape. So, once you come up to this sitting posture, you must feel you are symmetrical and you must feel you are relaxed. Before going into detail, I would say this posture is not a must. This is the theoretical maximum, this is the best. But many may find it is very difficult to go and sit like this due to the ailments and your old age and other problems. So under such circumstances, you have to adjust accordingly. For example, sitting on a meditation bench or straight back chair so that your back must be the spinal cord must be straight. So, therefore, whenever you go to a meditation hall, you may see many, many postures, many, many sitting benches and cushions, but this posture is the best. This posture is the ideal thing. So, if you are a yoga practitioner, easily you may assume it. Otherwise, don't make it a burden. Just sit in a comfortable way, and once you sit, in order to make your posture conducive, in order to make your posture to that level, your mind must be happily or in a relaxed way dwelling inside the body. I'm emphasizing it because if the posture is not comfortable, if the place is not ideal, if the place is not with medium amount of light and air movements, the body, mind feel uncomfortable, feel alienated, so it may run up and down and think yesterday and tomorrow and other places and other people. Unless otherwise you feel comfortable, you feel relaxed, you feel at home feeling, then only you can expect mind to dwell within the body, so to say. So now is the time to define the mindfulness. In the practical sense, whenever you sit and mildly close your eyes and to experience here, now, I am sitting. Or you can say, here, now, I am. So, this is the practically, this is the way you can feel whether the mindfulness is intact. So, if it is not so, if the mind feels uncomfortable, so you have to understand your preparation, your groundwork is not up to the mark. So it is just a common sense to make it comfortable, more make it relaxed, so that mind naturally will come and rest, dwell on the body. So once that is achieved, that is to say, here, now I am, so you step in to the mindfulness. To make it more emphatic or dramatic, I would say, if you are to keep the mind for a split second, thought moment, and to recognize that now I am here, you have to forget about the rest of the world. This is the biggest generosity, biggest generous action, generous thought moment you are entertaining. If you have any kind of a reference to the world or thinking about the yesterday and tomorrow, other places and other people, mind will never come and rest on the this particular the alignment, so to say, here now I am. So each and every thought moment, experiencing, appreciating, here now I am means you are increasing the number of thought moments on the mindfulness and you become, you are ready to forego the whole world. So therefore, it is something you can experience it. It is something to be promoted. It is something you yourself has to take responsibility. And do it in a relaxed way to keep the mind here and now. And when you are doing it, whenever the mind come to the one thought moment, you have no chance to experience it. So it must be number of thought moments, consecutive thought moments, then only you can experience here now I am. So it's a very spiritual thing. It's a very good start. So you try to be here now I am. So throughout that, you are within the body and experiencing just being. That is called just being. In technical sense, one can say, without any intention, without any ambition, without any motivation, so just be, just being. So whenever that is being familiarized, you may sometime experience there is a kind of a perception, there is a kind of a feeling to indicate you, I am not dead, I am not sleepy, I am not unfainted, I am awake. So your eyes are closed and mind feel comfortable at the body. And whenever the mind is mindful, or you can say diligent, you feel I am not dead. You can feel the existence, just being. You can feel I am not sleepy, I am not fainted. So this is a very good indication, very good sign that the mindfulness is continuing. So there the Buddha step in and he suggests whenever the mind to experience this here now I am moment, experience not dead, not sleepy, not fainted, the breath, the movement of air appear like the intrinsically the bare minimum activity of the involuntary muscles to maintain the life continuum. So some people at that moment will understand, in order to make sure that I am not dead, I am not sleepy, I am not fainted, the air movement. So that is a very good sign if you are to understand this respiration. You can see this is the indication, the bare minimum indication that I am living. I am living in the present moment. Then onward, lot of techniques, lot of methods and all the things are coming. So up to that moment, you must make the mind as clear as possible, as liberated as possible. Don't try to chase behind this method and that method. And that is the way you make the meditation very simple. Meditation become very straightforward. So you feel the living, the being. Sometimes with the rest, with the help of the breathing, or sometimes maybe without that also. So, to make the long story short, if you are to feel the breathing, you must make sure it is not forced breathing. You must make it sure it is happening through the involuntary muscles and it is happening in a natural way. Because many yogis, due to their too much of tension and too much of expectation of the results and kind of thing, chasing behind and ultimately they start artificial breathing and the forced breathing and end up with headaches and tensions. So therefore, make it as natural as possible. If the breath is not appearing well and good, you make sure here now I am. If the breath is happening, a lot of steps you can go forward, therefore it is good sign, but don't try to chase behind it. But don't worry thinking that I can't feel the breath. Supposing that you have the feeling, you have the contact with the breath, you let the breathing to take place in the natural speed and natural momentum, and there, if you are sharp enough, you may see the air movement and the breathing process, active process, is usually happening in your upper part of your body, and the lower part is just giving the anchorage to the upper part. So, if you are to recognize that, you can simply forget about the lower part of your body and bring the attention to the activity of breathing, even though it is you are not doing forced breathing. So, in order to bring the attention to the body, you have to forget about the whole world. If you wish to bring the attention to the upper part, you have to forget about the lower part. So, you have to understand the mindfulness is always relative. You have to be forgetful about something, then only the mindfulness becomes very sharp, very focused and very concentrated. If you are forgetful, if you are let go the whole world, your mindfulness on the body will be very bright. And when the breathing comes into seeing, if you are to focus on the upper part, you can see you are not worrying about, you just let go the lower part of the body. In order to let go, it must sit in comfortable, symmetrical way. That is why at the beginning you set it in a comfortable way. So suppose now we are to see natural breathing on the upper part of your body. You do it, you let it happen in the natural speed and observe as if someone else, as if you are a neutral observer, observing the breathing place, breathing process. So when it is happening, to make the mindfulness very sharp and make the mindfulness very continuous, yet another technique, yet another aspect you can be aware of, that is to say, within the upper part of your body, which is the most touching point, which is the most prominent touching point of the air draft. It's a very subtle issue. Many find it is difficult to locate a particular pinpointed point. Even if you find difficult, it is not a big mistake, it is not a big miss. But if you can find the touching point, and that make more and more focused mindfulness, that is you are giving a support to the concentration, the one-pointedness. Some people find it is at the uppermost area of the respiratory tract, that is to say end of the nostrils, or top of your upper lip, according to your configuration. Anatomical configuration. Some people find it the lowermost part of the respiratory tract, that is the diaphragm, movements of the diaphragm, prominent. Whenever you are reading authentic text, you find references towards the breathing, in-breath and out-breath. But later, Venerable Mahasi Shiado from Burma, he found the people, those who have not know much of subtle sensitivity, find difficult to locate the breath. So, under such circumstances, he came out with the second option, that is to say, rising and falling of the abdomen, that is the movements of the abdomen, movements of the diaphragm. It may be touching your clothing, or you may feel how is the rising and falling happen. One technical point is, if you are to look at the breath, in-breath start very subtle and become gross, brushing your nostrils and get out, and again it becomes subtle. Again the out-breath happen very subtle and brushing and rushing, and again subtle down, and therefore two waves per one breath, in-breath and out-breath. But if you are to look at the in-breath, the rising and falling, it is single wave, very big one. In-breath appear like increasing, and the highest rising and then falling happen. Therefore, instead of two small waves, in rising and falling, you may get one single big amplitude, big wave, so therefore its grossness is higher, so find easy to locate by the people, those who are not well trained. Therefore there is no comparison possible whether to go for breathing or whether to go for rising and falling. Let it happen in the natural way. You must be so sensitive, careful not to fork your fingers to select this or that. Let the body to select it. This, let the body knowledge to select it, whether your natural tendency is to observe the in-breath and out-breath at the nostril level or to see rising and falling in the abdomen. In between these two, some people may find the movements of the belly or the chest or the throat or the bend inside the nose, any place will be possible. If any such a thing happens, don't challenge it. Try to locate it and to anchor your attention to that. So that means you are focusing into that point and forgetting about the whole world. That is, in the Buddhist presentation, it's called one-pointedness. That is to say, you start with the whole body and bring the attention to the upper part and bring attention, if possible, to the rising and falling, the abdominal movements or the nostril. So now you know your attention is so sharp. So more and more you keep this point of touch longer, more and more you will be sharp in the mindfulness and very shortcut to the concentration. But this may be too much for a beginner. But without giving the whole total picture, I can't give the emphasis. That is why I try to give three stages: whole body, upper part of the body, and the touching point. And if you excuse me, I will give some more information that will be more digestible for the experienced yogis. That is to say, whenever, for example, if you take the breath as your object of meditation, primary object, when the breath is taking place under your very nose, that means full diligence, full vigilant, and mind is fully mindful, there are three facets, three things can represent the single process of so-called breathing. One thing is your touching point. You may see my breath is mostly touching the left nostril, right nostril, end of the nostril or top of the lip or whatever may be. And the second thing is, you are sure your mind is not wandering off with the sounds or thoughts or pains. Mind is with the breath. These two are generally easy to understand. But the third point is, if you are so sharp, if you are so diligent, if you are so vigilant, you may so clearly experience the in-breath versus out-breath. When the in-breath happens, you clearly can discriminately, discreetly, delimitedly say this is not out-breath. That is the subtlety, that is the sharpness, that is the diligence you are aiming at. So when the out-breath happens, your mind will so sure, you may see it is out-breath, it is not the in-breath, it is not the sound, it is not the pain, it is not the thought. So now your maintenance of mindfulness is just like a tightrope walking. Any single cracking sound or any pain, any thought can distort you. So therefore you must not be short-tempered. You must expect them whenever you are trying to keep the attention with the touching point and keeping on the breath and clearly, discreetly understanding in-breath and out-breath. The maintenance of it is just like learning how to ride a push bike, or a youngster going to start walking without any other instrument, how to walk tottering. One step, two step, and then collapsing again, getting up and learning. One step, two step like. So each and every yogi, every meditator will be a newly born baby, even to the breath, even to the mindfulness. So it is the way you become rejuvenated. It is, you must appreciate it. You must not worry about that I can't keep 2-3 breaths, or I can't, my mind is wandering, or my disheartening or self-criticism happen. It is quite natural. But your progress or your enthusiasm marked by how many breaths you can continue, or how many thought moments, or how many seconds, or how many minutes you can continue. So if it is catching, well and good. Your common sense or your caring must be to increase the contact, increase the number of thoughts, so increase the number of breaths, increase the number of seconds, increase number of minutes to keep as long as possible with your primary object. That is the technical part or sharp area in the meditation, what you call the sitting meditation. In order to facilitate this continuity of the mindfulness with your primary object, so late Venerable Maharshi Sayadaw came out with one technique, the labeling, the noting. That is to say, whenever you can bring the attention, get the mind, meditative mind on the track, that is to be face to face with the in-breath and out-breath, and if you wish to keep that undisturbed for a longer period, whenever the in-breath happens, you can note mentally in-breath, whenever the out-breath happens, as out-breath, or in-out. This labeling, this noting, helps regulate it to keep the track with the primary object. That's all you have to do. That's all you can do in sitting, because mind is so wandering, it is like a monkey mind. It is jumping from one to the other without any agenda. Don't make it a point to be worried. Instead, try to keep as long as possible in breath and out breath under the nose. Whenever the mind is wandered off, disturbed, again assume a beginner's mind. Again, try to again keep the mind on the in breath and out breath without any grumbling, without making any disappointments. Don't consider this failure as a individual failure, punishable failure. It is natural for each and every, so you have to have so much of sympathy in order to bring this positive energy up. So therefore, don't sit with the premeditated idea that I have to go for in-breath or go for rising and falling. Instead, let the body knowledge to select which is the most prominent object. Few sittings time, few days time, definitely you will recognize the most frequent object, that is to say primary object. And then outwardly only, your skeleton, spiritual skeleton will grow and you can keep the mindfulness and the concentration continuously. So this much I would like to mention about the sitting meditation. But I mentioned this noting in breath and out breath. That is the only tool you have in order to bring the mind back on the track. But you have a duty before the sitting, before coming to the sitting, if you can have a good walking meditation session, that your battery will be fully charged. So therefore, even though I try to give the instruction on sitting meditation, you may carefully observe the timetable. Timetable would say each and every sitting has to do after a walking meditation. So therefore, in a regular way, I would have explained the walking meditation first. But I find it is easy to introduce mindfulness in the sitting meditation, and same jargon, same terminology I can use for the walking meditation in the comparative way. That's why I wanted to paint a picture on the sitting meditation. Hoping that you grasp the idea, I would like to compare sitting meditation with the walking meditation so that definitely when you go home back, you will be more thankful, pay gratitude to the Nisarnavane, not due to this any other thing, but due to walking meditation. Even then we are little unsatisfactory as far as the walking paths are concerned. So you have the sand lawn, middle, And the upper, the round is fine room. There's another one just completed. So you all are lucky to have these two. Whenever these sand bits are not available, for example, for rain and any other kind of thing, so you have to use the indoor walking path. That is just an alternative for the sand bit. Sand bit is the best. For the males, they are better off because around the meditation hall, you have enough walking paths and they are prepared. They are not traditional, perfect this thing, but to make use the lawn as much as possible, put boundaries just like a swimming pool for a competition. So that is the part we call the walking path. And when you go out up, go to the monastery, males of course daily, but the others also may visit. There are some already set standard traditional walking paths meant for individual yogi, and that is in the separate kutis or separate dwelling places. But near the meditation hall, you have the common meditation path, but anyway, effect is the same. So in order to make the meditation path, you may see it's a flat ground, straight one, and laid down with half an inch of the soft sand. That is the luxurious treatment for the meditative life. So when you go back home, you try to make one. So whenever your architects are preparing the houses, ask them to include walking path, and it will be a very good gift for the your elderly people and the young children to do walking meditation, because sitting meditation is sour in taste, but the walking meditation very sweet. You can do as you like, irrespective of the age, irrespective of your health, and it is very healing and it is very rejuvenating. So therefore walking is very important. So much so, you may see for the last 30-40 years, all the denominations and all the religions came out with meditation. We Buddhist, traditional Buddhist teaching, we are the people meditating, but this is something lack of common sense. It's an every religion, they have meditation, but no one prescribed walking meditation, except the Buddha. And the Buddha says, if you wish to fulfill your task, the secret is in the walking meditation. If you have a proper digestion, if you have a lasting concentration, and if you wish to have rejuvenation without much of disease, bodily and physical, walking meditation in the path. So, when the talks are going, I will try to incorporate as much as possible the beneficial part of the walking meditation, but now I will reduce it to the pragmatic part, practical part. To compare with the walking meditation and the sitting meditation, you see, for the sitting meditation, as we mentioned, we are going to have a big meditation hall in the forest. We are going to have 5 feet by 5 feet square, 25 square feet for each individual. But for the walking part, we have to have a long stretch. We have to have 4.5 feet and 30-40 feet long stretch we need. We can make walking paths indoor and outdoor. Outdoor one is usually with the sand, indoor one is usually, in Sri Lanka we are happy, we are lucky, we have the coir carpets made out of coir. It's a very good alternative for the sand bed. And that means the walking path must be average enough for 30 steps. That means 40 to 45 feet long and 4 to 4.5 feet wide. So therefore, space-wise, this is only 25 feet square feet, that the walking path needs huge, long, bigger space. Other one is, as far as the postures are concerned, this is sitting posture, walking path, either standing or walking. And in sitting, in order to bring the attention inwardly, you are recommended to close your eyes. But in the walking meditation, you are asked to keep the eyes open. And when you are keeping the eyes open, you are not only concentrating on your touch of the tactile sensation of the body, but the eyes open, the ear is open for sounds, and the other one is, sitting is a very passive action. You are sitting, you give the posture symmetrical and relaxed, and you just let the breathing to take place. But in the walking, you have to have the intention. You have to do intentional work, walking, and therefore walking meditation is very dynamic, demanding. And attention, the mindfulness, the diligence is demanding so much because it has to fight through the sounds, the visual objects, and the intentional work as well as the touch of the ground. So to keep the touch intact, not like in sitting, it is challenging. But the point is, the touch of the ground by your soul is more gross, more prominent than touch of the air at your nostrils, or therefore the combination is different. So whenever you keep the legs, keep the foot, in the walking meditation, your object of meditation is the touch of the ground, how the soul is touching the ground, starting with the heel, spreading towards the toes, and how it is different from left leg, left sole to the right sole, and shifting of the energy, weight from the left leg to the right leg. So likewise, it is more challenging, and therefore, it theoretically accepted, in sitting meditation, it is more conducive for concentration together with the mindfulness, or I would say concentration with the mindfulness as the proximate cause. But in the walking meditation, the mindfulness is backed by energy, so therefore in the walking meditation you develop a lot of energy so that the metabolism and the bodily functions will be regulated. So therefore walking meditation is a preliminary work to have to aiming at the successful sitting. And many people, of course tomorrow at 1 o'clock, yeah, 1 to 1:30, we have question and answer session. Many will come out and ask, what is the speed of walking meditation? Because it's a technical aspect in the breathing, we call natural breathing. Walking also, many people try to regulate it, and it is not recommended. So therefore, the best is, you go and select your walking path, And this is the stretch I'm going to walk. And at the end of it, facing the walking path, stand still. Experience now, here now I am standing. There you may get the figure, not like a pyramid shape, but it's like a peg or like a candle. You feel you are standing on the ground, and make sure you are now in the present moment. Here, now, I am standing. And you are looking at your walking path that is supposed to take it as your for walking meditation. And if the body is not with much of any friction or any trouble, then you walk the distance that you determine, or what is the walking path is being meant, in a normal speed without any meditation, without any noting. Just let the body to make decision, what is my normal speed. So don't try to imitate slow walking or faster walking. Just let the body to walk, decide the body speed, and you must feel comfortable. You must feel familiarized with the walking path till that happens. Maybe a few minutes, you just keep on walking up and down in order to check the path, whether it is okay for me to walk, am I crossing other people, is there any weeds or any kind of thing like that. You are just walking in order to familiarize. Once you become familiarized, then only you take the meditative object, that is the soul. That means in the sitting meditation, your attention is in the upper part of the body, but in the walking meditation, your attention is definitely lower part of your body. So therefore, not to get mixed up, you are supposed to close, keep the arms in a non-swinging way in front of you or behind you, so that your attention will be simply going to the lower part of your body. So down onward, you are try to be with as when and where the right leg is keeping, you try to feel the touch of the ground by the right sole. When the left leg is keeping, you keep the touch with the left leg and keep as much as possible, but don't try to be restricted to it, because your eyes are bringing a lot of visions, ears are making a lot of noise, sounds, listenings, and the bodily movements make air movements. So let them be, but don't make it a point to worry. You keep touch with the right leg and the left leg. So this is how the walking meditation is happening. Even if you become a lover of walking meditation, an expert in the walking meditation, still the challenge is there. When you go to the end and when you are turning, definitely your mindfulness will be scattered off. Your concentration will be scattered off. So therefore, your prime task is to develop the concentration and the mindfulness in the middle pace. And when you go to the end, try to maintain that the same contributor of the mindfulness without breaking and bring it back to the other side. So therefore, that area must be free from normal beings and free from other activities and attractive things. Therefore, walking path must be very simple, well swept, plain sand, or a place like this with the koya mat or something like that. So whenever you are doing walking meditation, at least it takes 30 to 35 minutes to make the body familiarize with the action. So therefore, try to maintain 1 hour as much as possible. And if you develop the good harmony, develop the good concentration and the mindfulness due in walking meditation, go and sit with the same calibration, same peace of mind, and then you can feel the body is happy to sit after walking about 45 minutes, 1 hour. Sitting will be comfortable, adjust yourself and give the mindfulness to the primary object, and you can see it is more going more and more deeper than without walking meditation. And that is how the walking meditation and the sitting has to go in hand in hand. And the other general ethical benefits are, if you all are interested in teaching meditation for the younger people, don't prescribe sitting meditation. Ask them to go and do walking meditation, they will find it very easier. And if you wish to prescribe it to your parents and the elderly generation, they also find very difficult to sit and wait. And the walking is easier. Even if you have fallen into sickness and recovering, don't cramp yourself into the sitting meditation. Go for walking meditation. You may find you will be recover fast, and the body will let you know, okay, now you go and sit, and then that will be successful. So therefore, walking meditation has a wider application, but unlucky enough, nowadays, very little emphasis given to walking meditation, so therefore continuity is disturbed. So don't let that weakness creep into your meditation. Give 50% time, 50-50 on sitting and walking. You can see in the timetable, each and every walking meditation has to follow with the sitting meditation. So this is the way we try to keep the mindfulness in sitting and walking. And to end my presentation, I would like to take little time how to extend this further into our day-to-day activities. That is important, because you don't find walking paths at your home. You don't get this kind of atmosphere and the sitting meditation halls at your place. So therefore, if you can touch, if you can feel, if you can have a sense on the how to be mindful in the walking day-to-day activities, that assimilate your normal day back at home. So therefore, you have to understand sitting is more to the depth, and the day-to-day activities in mindfulness is to the breadth, the wider aspect. And the multitasking is there, the time pressure is there, and sometimes socialization is there. So therefore, you can't expect kind of a concentration on the day-to-day activities, but you can maintain a meager continuity of mindfulness. But even then, it is very versatile. It is quite appreciable. So therefore, in the day-to-day activities, if you wish to maintain the mindfulness, we introduce that in SMS, slowly, mindfully, silently. Slowly means, whenever you wish to be mindful, so to say, one task when you are doing by yourself, just like brushing your teeth or washing yourself, any kind of thing, if you wish to incorporate mindfulness, do these tasks specifically in the meditation center in a little slow manner. Then mind is more self-conscious. So that itself, the slow doing itself is a reminder for you to be mindful. So therefore, the yogi, don't rush as much as possible. Keep your pace little slower than the normal speed. And the second thing is, don't try to be mindful throughout the day as a beginner. Select most conducive conditions, conducive postures, conducive tasks, and try to be mindful with them at the beginning. When I started my teacher, he asked me, don't go for sitting meditation, no walking meditation. I was so busy. He just asked one task a day just to start. That is to be mindful while brushing the teeth. That's the only starting point. He told you are daily doing it by yourself. And regularly you will be in the same time, same place. So therefore just try to feel the brush touching the mouth and the gums and teeth and just experience it. And do it slowly and try to be mindful. So this you consider as a special task to increase the mindfulness in your day-to-day activities. And the Buddha, explaining in the Satipatthana Sutta, he has item by item, he has itemized when you go forward, when you come back. When you look forward, when you look sideways. When you are stretching your arm, when you are bending your arm. When you are washing your bowl, when you are washing your robe, when you are listening, keeping silent, sleeping, and go to the toilet and doing the first and the second job. Each and everything is being itemized. So much of compassion he has given, he is sharing with his own personal experience. So therefore, whenever you are going to be mindful in the day-to-day activities, you are broadening the concept of mindfulness, that is, to be here and now, as much as possible to the simple tasks you do in a routine way. And if you are daily going to make a tag, daily when I am brushing, I must be mindful. Or any other kind of thing, my teacher told, it is like a ink drop system. When you take a blotting paper, first time you wipe it out your fountain pen, it make a patch. Next day you keep it, again it gets a patch. Ultimately, slowly, slowly, patches are increasing, more and more you use it. Likewise, slowly, slowly you can increase one by one, so task by task, to be mindful in the day-to-day activities. And the third one is silently, it has a very different meaning. If you try to be mindful, you must listen to your own sounds, whatever the task you are performing. It's a very magnetic feature. If you are listening to yourself, naturally you become mindful. When you are washing dishes, brushing yourself, doing something, you see, if you are unmindful, you may be slamming the doors and don't care about other people kind of thing. It is due to this arrogant nature. But if you are careful about not to disturb others, to maintain the silence, if you wish any kind of silence treatment, first and foremost, you have to make sure you are not making unwanted sounds. You are not emitting unwanted sounds. You are not polluting the surrounding by unwanted sounds. More and more you try to do it in a silent way. Naturally, you become self-awareness, self-conscious. So ultimately, you will be a good example for the others also. And whenever someone is doing very harsh and slamming, those kind of things, you can understand, poor fellow is not mindful. That's it. That is what I was. Now I am careful. But don't try to find fault with the person. That is because he has not trained himself. He is not being, has a mutual understanding of each other. That is why it happens. But don't make it a point for you to slam again the door. You have to take care. So therefore, silently, mindfully, slowly, these things will give the kind of a hint for you to be mindful in the day-to-day activities. So one, yet another point I can make. For example, in your walking, you are keeping the touch with moving left leg and the right leg. In the breathing, of course, you are keeping the attention in one place. But in walking, you are keeping on the right leg and then immediately shifting into the left leg, right leg, left leg. So you are feeling the crumbly feeling of your foot. And in the day-to-day activities, you take the, not only the sole, even with the palms. Whatever you touch it, you feel its shape, the hardness, the warm, cold kind of thing. The other tentacles of our sensuous body. So whenever it is touching, if you are aware of it, you see, the in order to make a data confirm, our mind read two ways, one suggestion and the second seconding. Suggestion, if it is coming by an eye, the seconding happened by touch. If the suggestion coming by touch, the seconding has to come by seeing. See, in the darkness, if you touch it something, you feel, but if you have to switch on the light and see the same thing, then only the confirmation happens. Then only the seconding happens. So therefore, eyesight and the touch. These are the two things. Whenever it comes together, your experience is solid. So, they are the touch play good role. So when you are walking, you can feel each and every step by sole. But when you are touching, you can feel by the palms how the feeling happens. So it's a clear indication you are here and now. So this is how mindfulness we are diversifying, we are increasing towards the day-to-day activities. Of course, when you are here, we have limited amount of personal activities. That when you go home, definitely multitasking and all the kind of thing. So therefore, again, the challenge is bigger back at home. But we'll discuss it later. But for the moment, try to introduce the mindfulness and then maximize under the sitting meditation, walking meditation and the day-to-day activities and see how all the three are integrated together, taking hand in hand together or reciprocal each other, then only you are worth calling a yogi. Then only you are worth calling a meditator. Till that you are a beginner. So try to incorporate all the things and ultimately you may feel that from morning to the evening, you have the continuity of the mindfulness. Of course, with some breakage and disturbances, but that is the one you are maximizing. So that is called Satipatthana or the foundation of mindfulness. And according to the traditional Buddhist circles, the biggest skillfulness you can achieve in life. So sometimes it's called biggest merit. Merit also have the synonym like a skillfulness. So this is because the mindfulness have the end you can comprehend because your attention is inward. That is why it is called insight. But the physics, chemistry, biology and all the other sciences are outwardly no end. It's a cul-de-sac, endless bag. Whatever you do, you will it, you can't fulfill it. But the Buddha found a completely traditional way, put inwardly and he says, your body itself, take it as a laboratory, put mindfulness into that and see, day by day, you will understand one aspect by one aspect. And one day you will understand exactly the same thing in the other person. For the moment you would consider you are a male, you are a female, you are blah, beep, all the kind of things. But when the mindfulness happens, you will understand the humanity exactly in the everyone. So you go through your personal approach, your personal likings and dislikings, your personality, you take it as object of meditation, and when you go there, deep down there, the general human nature is touching. And that is the sometimes in the Mahayana tradition they call Buddha nature. But as far as you are superficial, as far as you are unmindful, as far as you are in the sensuous gratification, you are more and more fertilizing your likings and disliking your personalities and making so much of fuss or conflict. But instead, if you go deep into that, you can understand the human mind. So therefore, if you are to understand more and more about yourself, but it is not the second-hand knowledge, but under the note experience, easily you can understand other person why he or she is behaving like that. So that is the way you develop sympathy. Ultimately, even to the animal beings, even to the plants, even to the non-living beings, you can spread it. So therefore, mindfulness has a very tiny, simple, straightforward start, but the end, we can say it is the omniscient knowledge. But that is not necessary in order to get to emancipation. So the Buddha depicted his omniscient knowledge, and out of that he told, if you went on the way back, on the way halfway, you will understand the skillfulness and the unskillfulness. So mindfulness is the mirror, mindfulness is the reflection. You can understand how much you develop insight towards the face-to-face understanding or under the nose experience. So task is easily definable. So we take this time during the retreat as much as possible to achieve this task through this single tool of mindfulness. Of course, a lot of other variables are there, but in the introduction, this is what I would like to emphasize. So I hope you all may experience a good mindful retreat. Thank you very much for participation.